गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। हाँ यस सर।
सर एक स्टूडेंट्स ने छे ना, स्टूडेंट्स को आप इन्फॉर्म कर दीजिए कि इन बिटवीन अगर किसी को डाउट है, सपोज बहुत सारे काफी सारे स्टूडेंट्स ऐसे भी होते हैं कि जो क्वेश्चन पूछने से शाय अवे करते हैं लास्ट में, हमारे जो लेक्चर होने के बाद क्वेश्चन आंसर सेशन है तो उसमें कभी नहीं भी पूछते हैं, तो जब भी उनको कुछ क्वेश्चन इन द मीनवाइल कुछ डाउट अराइज होता है तो वो लिख दें अंदर हमारे कमेंट सेक्शन।
हाँ, चैट चैट कोई चैट बॉक्स में लिख सकते हो आप लोग।
लास्ट में स्पीकर जो है वो टेक अप कर लेंगे।
ओके ओके सर। सो आई रिक्वेस्ट एवरी पार्टिसिपेंट दैट इफ यू हैविंग एनी डाउट्स एंड यू आर बी इफ यू आर फीलिंग वेरी शाय टू आस्क द क्वेश्चन यू कैन राइट इट टू द चैट बॉक्स। सो आफ्टर दैट स्पीकर विल गिव दैट आंसर अकॉर्डिंग टू दैट। सो now we are going to start our third day and first session of the 5-day vocational training program on emerging technological intervention for fisheries and aquaculture development. Now we have with us our honorable dean sir, principal and dean sir, Dr. A.Y. Desai sir. We are also having with us our renowned speaker Mr. Pankaj Kishore sir, who is working in CIFT as a scientist in quality assurance and management division of ICAR CIFT Cochin since 2014. He is expertise in food microbiology, in particular with fish and fishery product, molecular biology, advanced instrument techniques and biotoxins. He is looking after NABL, that is National Accreditation Board for Testing and Calibration Laboratories, which is a constituent board of Quality Council of India. He is a member of Seafood Processing Approval into our Seafood Processing Industries, and he is the member of Institutional Animal Ethics Committee, and under him 10 master degree and 2 PhD students completed their degrees. He has published more than 20 national and international publications in a reputed journal with a good ranking. Apart from that, he has also written a book chapters and popular articles into his career. So now I welcome Dr. Pankaj Kishore sir into our training program. I also welcome Dr. S.I. Yusufzai, who is the head of department of aquaculture department, and I welcome every students into the second day and the third day first session. So now I'm handing over this session to our Pankaj Kishore sir, who will describe about the regulatory requirement for fish and fishery trade. So Pankaj sir, please sir, proceed.
Am I audible, Ketan?
Yes sir, you are audible.
Thank you very much for a nice introduction, and this is my first class for Veerawal Fisheries College, and it is very nice to be with the BFSC graduates. Good morning to your Dean Desai sir also and the senior colleagues. So and today we are going to have something which is very confined but very essential in each and every aspect. So better I will start sharing things, right? So is it visible?
Yes sir.
Okay. So we are going to have today about the regulatory requirements and fish and fisheries trade. Actually, this is whether you have classes there on this, Ketan?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
You have classes for this because Veerawal is a big industry for in respect of fisheries. So students should be very much aware about all such things. Here I have tried to compile everything, whatever important is there, so that they will be very much acquainted and they should know the importance first. Otherwise, yesterday what it was a class which is very much essential, particularly in the supply chain, your blockchain technology. But here, apart from those technologies, now governments, every government, they are taking care of that so that the food, whatever it is consumed by the general public, it has to be very safe. Here, first we need to understand about what is the food safety and food security. So food safety, actually it refers to the process of scientific organization that describes ways to deal with manufacture and store through ways to prevent foodborne diseases. So this is the most important thing what we are. Now we are also going through the COVID. So there are also myth or it is reality, we don't know. Through soy food, in between it was there, from seafood it has come. So, but it is completely unknown still what it is exactly. But basically why food safety is required, it is to prevent from foodborne diseases. Why foodborne diseases? To prevent human health. See, it is, we human are much more important. If we have some problem, it is not only an individual loss, it is a loss of complete economy of complete country, and thereafter it a loss of you can say world also. And the health issues, now it has become more important, and now we can very well realize how much important this topic will be, and why the government and regulatory agencies are so much careful, and they are particularly emphasizing more. Now you can see the FSSAI, so they are very much active in such aspects. And it is nothing to have some fastidious rule for or some stringent rule for the business people. People mismanipulate that, that yes, because they want to inhibit, but it is not the inhibition. It is what exactly it is to prevent human health, okay? Because each and individual are very important. So if individual will not be there,
Pankaj sir, okay.
Ketan, am I audible?
Yes sir, yes, now you are audible, sir.
Okay, now it's okay.
Okay, sir, you can continue.
So in between, actually, I would like that people should talk to me. Otherwise, it will be very monotonous, and I am talking and only I am listening. It is a feeling like that.
Okay, sir.
Ketan?
We will be with you, sir. We will be with you, sir. We are also
what
starting our
students?
Video also.
What about the students?
We will also, sir.
A few students, please,
sir. We will interact with
if
you.
If they, if
okay, because yes. See, something which is very important, and every walks of life you will have this. See, even if you are a state official, you need to know such things. Okay, and definitely, if you are a professor, if you in any aspect, these things will be important. If you are an entrepreneur, also you have to know, because you have to deal with. Otherwise, you cannot do any business also. Okay, so let me go with that, the food safety and the food security. So food safety is particularly, it is the process of scientific organization. That way, it describes all the aspects in particular to prevent from any foodborne diseases. And what is the food security? So this is the adequacy of food to the society. So what I was talking about for the human, so everybody is working or everybody is surviving, and every day they are struggling only for the food. So there the food security is a concern, and where it is defined with the equitable distribution, confirmed supply. It is not that today you are giving and for next 7 days people are not eating. So that is also not, cannot be categorized in the security part. And then fair assess, everybody should have assessed for that, and sustained resource, what I was telling, so continuous supply has to be there. So here you can see I have given a graph given a picture which is very well defined. See, if we are losing this food safety and security, it will lead to poverty, and poverty ultimately it will make loss. Either it will be with the human and economy as well. So food safety, when you see, it will be your raw material. Yeah, it will compile your processing. Then you can see the pathogens and ultimate, and then the cross contamination. So all these are interlinked in respect of food safety. Then when you see the food security, it is the food utilization, how it is being utilized, how the people are, whether they are accessible to food or not, and accessibility, when it will be important, when that will be available. So all these things are interrelated. And now very well we can see the climate change, what is making more emphasis on it. And because of this climatic change, you can very well see now these days also unwanted rains, anytime heat will be there, anytime cold is there. So that is also completely affecting our microflora and the systems, what it is. So then you can see I have a different type of logo. So all regulatory agencies are there, which are most dominant across the world. And in India, you can see FSSAI is there. So these food standards are very much mandatory for international trade. So in the subsequent slide, you will come to know how and why it is so much important. And particularly for the developing countries, the exporters need to go for the high value food market. Now already you can listen this, even PM, Prime Minister is also talking about your shrimp exports. So that has to be tripled, or MPDA also. So there are a lot of things, and particularly people are emphasizing. So how you can penetrate those high value markets? Okay, high value market means where you can get a good return when you are selling your product. So that can be your US, your European Union. So those kind of developed countries. And when you will have your good market share, and this can only be happened when you are internationally competent. Okay, when you are equal and when you are give good product. So in order to do, you have to respond adequately to the consumer. So ultimately, if you see with the slide, it will go to the consumer. Who is the consumer? It is us, or the people around. And these consumers, now you can see, earlier we were not very much thinking about, okay, anywhere we will sit and eat. But now wherever we are going, we will think of whether it is a dhaba or we are going to the restaurant. So ultimately, what is the things behind in our mind? It is the quality and the safety, whether we will be healthy or not. So before going to particular standards and those regulations, I would like to tell you about what is the scenario now. And this is the most updated one. So total fish, global fish production, if you see, it is 179 million tons. And there, if you see, out of 179, 156 million tons are for human consumption. Okay. And there you can have, and this is the global scenario what we are talking about. It is not Indian scenario. And when we are taking the globe, it is around 20.5 kg per capita. Okay. And when you see this aquaculture account almost 46% of the total production, and in that 52% is going for the human consumption. Okay. And you can see only 12% has gone for the non-food purposes. And in that 44%, this live, fresh, chilled fish have been the largest share, which was utilized for human consumption in 2018. And this, when you see the weight, it is around 67 million tons of the fish, which was traded internationally. So this is the big chunk where we are going to emphasize on. Now you can see the India, where India stands. India stands at the fourth with the 4% in their export. just after China, Norway, Vietnam. And thereafter, in the same pipeline, you can see it is India, Chile, your Thailand, USA, and Netherlands, and some big countries like Canada, they are still behind. And it is all happening because now we are very well growing, very well in aquaculture side and technological side also in the wild culture also. And this, you can see only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And these 10 countries, they are accounting almost more than 50% of the share for the export. In the Indian scenario, when you see, I have already told India is among the top 7 capture producers. So among that 50% of the total what we are producing and the fourth biggest seafood exporter in the world. And when we see more than 476 billion Indian rupees, we are earning from that. And when we go for the employment, it is 14.5 million people are employed. And now you can see very well in the northern side also, northern India. So people are taking up this aquaculture because as it is much more profitable in comparison to even agriculture and others. And if you see directly or indirectly, you can take the sailor or the middleman or who is there with all businesses. So they account almost 40.5 million people in that. So when we see the processing sector, so there are almost 450 processing plants, and among 450, you can see 60% are European Union approved plants. Okay, so, and almost every plant has put in HACCP and the quality systems because they have to compete with the world and they have to give highest quality outputs. And many are even there with ISO certificates. Then apart from that, the total registered exporters are almost 1,100. In that 1,100 exporter for frozen fish, and mostly we are exporting frozen fish. We are not going for the means value added products. And why it is we are not going? Because of the risk what is involved. And people are not taking, although it is a multiple type, multiple time earning will be there, but still this is risk free. So in Indian context, if you see, so they are going more for the frozen. And in the canned and retort pouch, if you see, only 16 are there. Then the freeze dried, only 4 are there. And other subsequent, you can see almost 200, which are involved in such activities. So, among that, maximum earning we are getting from the frozen fish, which is being exported, and that is earning almost 35,000 crore. And when you see in the dollar terms, it is almost $5,000 million. So, which is accounting around 51% in quantity. And when you see the value, it is almost 73%, more than 73%. And now, every year you will see the changes, who are the most big importers of the Indian seafood products. So now it is US and China, which are our major markets. Now come to the why we are talking about safety and quality. So you can have this data we have taken, I have taken from World Health Organization site. So you can see more than 200 diseases ranging from diarrhea to cancer, they are only because of unsafe food, which are containing your either harmful bacteria, virus, parasite, or any chemical substances, which you can categorize. If you have read about HACCP, so there you must have read about your chemical hazards and physical hazards. So all this comprises in that. And from these, more than 200 diseases, almost 600 million. So you can think of 1 in 10 people in the world are getting sick because of this contaminated food. Even we don't know, okay, how, why we got sick and why we have such problems, because these are something hidden contaminants which has to be taken care. So you can see around 420,000 are dying every year, and it is what it is reported, and unreported you can very well think of how great the graph will go on. And as I was talking about, it is not the human health only. You can see nearly $110 billion every year it is lost in the productivity and medical expenses. And only this is because of unsafe food in the low and middle income group. So they here they have not included your developed countries. And many are, it many comes reporting and unreporting. So that is still a matter of talk. So there we are not going into it. But whatever reports are available, so you can see how much it is discouraging in respect of human health, means we are not so much bothered, and so much loss we cannot account. And we can see the children, so under 5 years of age, there 40% are carrying your such foodborne diseases because they have the habit of eating everything. And in that you can see 125,000 deaths are happening. So almost you can very well compare total death and your age who are under 5 years. And maximum illnesses, why it is happening, only because of diarrheal diseases, which is causing around 550 million people. They are getting sick with that, and 230,000 deaths are occurring every year. Now, why these standards are needed for the India? Stringent quality requirement of the global market. They are very strict with that, and increasing in importance with the Codex Commission and the advent of SPS agreements with the WTO. Now it has been appreciated, and to implement your international level of food safety. And ultimately, if you see, we are looking for maximum for export so that we can earn more. So these all come under the part of agreement with the SPSS and the WTO, which describes your minimum sanitary and phytosanitary standards that WTO member countries must achieve to ensure safety of life and health of human, animal, and plants as well. So in the sanitary and phytosanitary requirement quality standard, India is also a member of WTO, who has adopted sanitary SPS agreement provided by the World Trade Organization and which adopted by the Codex. Then India has also accepted the quality standards from the different commodities which has been prescribed, and there they have also adopted the traceability, and with the traceability it has given the confidence of the importing countries and to help to avoid repeat testing of the product in the importing countries. Then your food safety management system certification is key.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, what is phytosanitary?
Plant sanitation. Okay. See, that SPS combines all your animal, plant, including human. Okay. So that is why they have defined the term. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So that food safety management certification scheme has already been accepted by BIS, our Bureau of Indian Standards. So guidelines of the Codex is the key reference used to the developing standards and the Codex. So those guidelines can directly be adopted by the referring countries, and a few have been adopted even by the India. Okay, the application of SPS and the technical barrier is applied to encourage the international harmonization. So ultimately, whatever you have your reports, so it will be completely one and people will accept, and they will accept your consignments. So seafood safety standards and handling and hygiene practices of fish along the entire supply chain is now being monitored. Monitoring is required. Ultimately, if you see, everything is linked and it will go with the two things, your human health and your risk. Okay. So in all the regulation and procedures of fish handling and transportation, safety codes are incorporated to avoid hazards and risk. Sustainability of the resources, what I was talking in the very first slide, and the safety of consumer and the success of entrepreneur are focus of the proposed regulation and the code of practice by the regulatory agencies. If you want to see what all the guidelines are there for the different countries, so you can very well assess the Glowfish. Okay, so there you can have information and analysis of the whatever the fish trades are happening across the world. So you can see Argentina, China, Chile, Europe, Japan, Mexico, almost all countries are there who are doing your fish trade. Now, one by one, we will go to the most important nations and how their regulations are. So first we will go with the European Union. So there you can see the general food laws. So there, what it will be important to remember the numbers. Okay. Because for the students, I think they will be asked about the number. They will not be asked that, okay, what it deal with. So from my side, I would like to say the students should remember such kind of numbers. Okay. And here I will explain about what this regulation says. So your European Commission regulation number 178/2002, which gives the general principles and requirement of food laws, establishing the European Food Safety Authority and laying down procedures in matters of food safety. Then when we talk about the hygiene of the foodstuffs, so there it is 852/2004, which will describe your foodstuff hygiene, your hygiene and official control rules for bivalves in particular, because bivalves are mostly consumed raw. So there it is more risky, and there maximum chances of your microbiological contaminants, like mostly your vibrios and your biotoxins, your PSP, paralytic shellfish poisoning. You must have read about that. So their occurrence will be directly. So there you have to remember, it is 852/2004, which is deal with the hygiene. Okay. Then specific hygiene rule are there for animal and food also. So when they are talking about the bivalves, you have to tell about the 852. Then when they are talking about the other foods, it has to be 853. Then the microbiological criteria, it has been separately given in regulation number 2073/2005. Then in the 2017/625, that regulation is on official control and other official activities performed to ensure the application of food and feed laws, rules on animal health and welfare. So here you think of all three things will be combining with the regulations, your human, your plant and your animal as well. Okay, because this way or other way, all are linked. So that is why these have been prescribed. Then your 624/2019 is concerning a specific rule for the performance of official control on the production of meat for production and relying area of live bivalve mollusk. Then your 627, which is giving uniform practice arrangement of the performance of official control on the product intended for human consumption. Here you cannot apply for feed or other things which is given to the pets. So here it specifically it is mentioned that intended for human consumption. So when it will be there, then only you can apply such regulations. Then there are separate rules for the chemical contaminants. So now chemical contamination is too much when you see about the antibiotics, your pesticides. So there they have let down the regulation of 1881/2006, which is giving maximum level what it can be accepted for a foodstuffs for and the food additives. So there it is 1333/2008. And then 37/2010, which is giving for pharmacologically active substances and their classification with their limits, how much it is acceptable. And a lot of rejections you must have heard about. So these all comes under such regulations for the European Union. Okay. Then you see the directive 99/2002. It is laying down the animal health rules governing the production, processing, distribution, and introduction of the product of animal origin for human consumption. Then your 626 is the list of third countries. Okay, let it be this third countries you don't bother about so much. So why it is called? So for the what you can say their low income group, low income countries you can say. So they are the authorized for the entry into the European Union of certain animal. So they are following the 626 2019. So Commission implementing rules and regulation of 2021/30/2019 establishing detailed rules of operation to be carried out during and after documentary checks, identifying checks and physical checks on animal and goods subjected to official control at the border control post. So simply you cannot enter. So there are also regulation where the border check will be there. So once clearance will be done, then only it will enter. Okay, then a lot of talks about the traceability. So for traceability also they have laid down the rules, which includes 1005/2008. Then and this 1005 is for a community to prevent, deter, and eliminate illegal, unreported, and unregulated fishing. So in the short form, you must have heard, maybe not the full form, that IUU fishing regulations by the FAO. So that is nothing but that it is illegal, unreported, and unregulated fishing, which will come under 1005/2008. Then 1224/2009 establishing a community control for ensuring compliance with the rules of common fisheries policies. Okay, so this will go to your harvesting site, not to the post-harvest site. So they have to comply with that. And 1379 on the common organization of the markets for the fisheries and aquaculture products. So whatever the organizations are there, they also have to comply with certain regulations. So those very detailed guidelines are also available. After European Union, Canada, so all countries, they can have their separate regulations. So Canada is also having food laws and then supplementary policies regulation, including your selfish sanitation control programs and then your management for contaminated fisheries regulations. So whatever regulations are there only to curtail or to check from the risk. Then your Japan also has, so Japan External Trade Organization, which look after all such things, who maintains a list of Japanese standards and regulation concerning imports and procedure, quarantine period, your technical requirement, things. And in that there you can have Food Sanitation Act, Quarantine Act, Act on the Protection of Fisheries Resources. So the same your Japan ETO provides guidelines in the form of handbooks, so which will have your agriculture and fisheries products import regulations. So what all the regulations are there. So it will be in the one form, which you can very well assess. Then separate guidelines are there for the food and food additives. Then specification standard and testing methods are also there. It is nothing that you can do whatever your lab methods are there. It is not acceptable at all, and nobody will accept. So whatever testing methods are prescribed there, you have to go with that. And for the import also, they have the procedures along with your hygiene control. Then USA, that FDA, US Food and Drug Administration, which look after all such regulation and legislation, your guidelines, and they give the advice documents also. And these important documents includes your Food Safety Modernization Act, Fisheries and Fish and Fisheries Products Hazards and Control Guidance, your rules on the Foreign Supply Verification Program, FSVP, for the imports, then guidelines for your industries, and then now labeling also. So in your block technique, it was mainly emphasizing on traceability and labeling. Okay, because in labeling, a lot of frauds are happening and maximum rejections are happening. Not rejection, you can say recalls are happening because of labeling. Okay, so they actually, as per the guidelines, they have to label, suppose it is allergen, but they are not labeling at all. So to keep everything under control, they also have come out with the certain guidelines. So that is there. So complete guidelines for the operation of bivalves, selfish sanitation program in the United States. It is, which is called National Selfish Sanitation Program, which guide complete molluscan cell feces. So all controls will be done through those guidelines. Then the codex.
Sir, what is the difference between rejection and recall?
Recall, how it happens, suppose that consignment already has gone into the market and it has been distributed to many retails. Okay. So what regulatory agency tells that has to be taken back. Okay. Understood. Suppose company is there. Okay. So it is going to the different market, and then it is known that it is containing that risk or labeling problem is there. Okay. So it will be recalled. Okay. They can take it back. Okay. But in the rejection, that doesn't happen. It depends on the importing countries what they are going to do with.
Okay.
So the Codex Alimentarius Commission is a joint body of FAO and WHO, who has to produce international standards and other documents relevant to food hygiene. And why they are coming out? Only to harmonize things. It is not that I will have my own guidelines and you will have your own guidelines. See, some common point has to be there where everybody has to accept. And that is how this, you can say, it's a kind of server which is connecting everybody, and there people are agreeing, okay, ye achha hai bhai, yehi sahi hai. So for the exporting company, exporting country and importing countries also. So they maintain all such kind of synchronized things and mutual agreements so that the trade can smoothly happen. The CAC was established in 1963, and now there are 189 members in this, 188 member countries and one member organization, which is European Union is there. And India is also very well part of your codex. And the codex, that FAO maintains the list of Codex Alimentarius Code of Practices, Standard and Guidelines on their website, which will include your general principles of food hygiene, Code of Practices for Fish and Fisheries Products, Standards for Live and Raw Bivalve Mollusk, then guidelines on the application of general principles of food hygiene, to the control of pathogenic Vibrio in seafood, not all Vibrios. Then guidelines on the application of the general principles of food hygiene to control the viruses in the food. Now, that was the world scenario. Now we can go to Indian scenario. So there, under the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, FSSAI, Food Safety and Standard Authority of India is working on. Then our CIFT is also there, which is a part of ICAR. Then Coastal Aquaculture Authority is there, who has to provide the establishment of coastal aquaculture for regulating the activities connected with the coastal aquaculture in the coastal areas and for the matters connected with that. Okay, then for the international trade, your Ministry of Commerce is there, who is taking after. Then there are now, you can see very well different portals. If you browse through, you will get separate portals are there for TPT, TBT and SPS also. So Indian, for whatever things are you want to know, now it is your hand tip and you can very well see. And your MPDA is also there. So they are mostly regulating your national trade, your trade promotions, then foreign trade policies and procedures. So what TBT actually says, your TBT is actually a technical barrier to trades. Okay, technical regulations and the product standards, which can be vary from country to country. So different regulation and standards, it is very hard for the producer and the means exporter and importer to go to the different market. So to come out to have a common harmonized things, such kind of agreement came, and they let down with the, your regulation standards and testing, and with that your certification procedure, so that there must not be any unnecessary hindrances. So WTO members are not prevented from taking measures necessary to ensure their standards. If somebody wants to come out with a good preventive protocol which will really benefit human health, so they are very well welcomed there.
Sir, excuse me.
Sir,
this technical barriers to trade is somehow related to tariffs on trade or tax
those tariffs and other things I will tell you. Okay, so everything will be there. Okay, so ultimately it will go to tariff, your anti-dumping and those things were there. No, so that I will tell you here. Okay. So there now we have one national notifying agency which is working under Ministry of Commerce and Industry. So these are publishing all sanitary and phytosanitary measures and notifying changes in SPS measure. If suppose I have to change something with that, that agency only has to do, okay, not anybody else. Okay, so with that TBT agreement, each member is mandated to create an inquiry point. That is why our national inquiry point was created, for answering any question. If anybody is having anything, so they have to go with that. And your BIS has been designated as WTO TBT inquiry point. Whatever things are related to your trade and this kind of confusion, so you can very well assess BIS, so they will clarify. For the import Directorate General of Foreign Trade, then FSSAI and your BIS is looking after. Then for the export, your Export Inspection Council of India, who is looking after, which will look after all the products. It is not only the seafoods, other things also. When we see for the regulators for the foreign trade, you can see I have already told FSSAI, then all such are actually interlinked. And universities also, why, how universities are working, it is because they are involved in the your testing part. Okay, so that is why you can see universities are also there. Then your CIFT and many organizations which are involved. So they are linked directly for regulating the foreign trade. In Export Inspection Council, they had a Government of India notification of SAO 730, which was published in 1995. So under these guidelines and subsequent amendments in 2001 and 2002 and then 3, they have let down the requirements for approval of seafood establishments, which are meant for export, not for imports. So they, in this guideline, they have given all the details, what establishment has to do with what what industries should have. Then only your export can happen. So based on such guidelines, only the competent authority will approve the establishment for processing seafood for exports. Then there, mainly the primary responsibility lies with the processing establishment, your factory vessel, your freezer vessels, where we are also part of that. Then establishments are required to plan and implement detailed HACCP based on your process control and to maintain necessary records. So these records are very much important. So when your auditors are going, so they are not going and looking things for years. So they will only look after your records, how it is. And if any manipulations are there, very well, your records can very well see, be seen by the auditors. So there it is must to have appropriate records and well maintained so that you can satisfy the auditors and then only your approval can be given. Then role of AIA is to maintain exercise official control for approving unit that I already have told, and effective surveillance system also to ensure compliance. So regular surveillance are happening, monitoring is there. So that is how our trade is also going up. Then applications complete in all aspects. So that is their administrative things. But there you can see, earlier it was IDP, now it is assessment panel of expert who is going and assessing the things and then they are approving. So what are responsibilities of approved establishments will be there? So they have to look for your sanitation and hygiene control, which will compile. You can look into it, this your complete GMP IHSSP, sanitation and hygiene control, water quality, traceability, your residue monitoring, very well your records. Then apart from that, the people who have been hired there, your technologists. So your organoleptic check also has to be done regularly, your microbiological checks, and all such records have to be there. And when if additives have people are using, so there they have to look for the residue of additives, what level it is actually present. If they are having salts, so those salts should be free from your staph and other sulfide reducing clostridium. And some, suppose your chilled fishes are being exported and big fishes, so there you need to look after the histamine contents, which is mandatory. And there, why I am talking these things, actually these things are very much important. Your health certificates are also important, that has to be taken by EIC, then only your export can happen. Then there are Export Inspection Council of India for the ministry is the competent authority for verifying and certifying. So they, this EIC is only giving compliance certificate with your fisheries and aquaculture products, and these are under the Direct 91/493. And this people should remember, it is a very essential and very common, but we will not get. What should be the chlorination level in the establishment. So if you are processing or glazing, it has to be 2 ppm or less. It should not be more. But when you have the hand dip, it has to be 20 ppm. Then when you are going with the foot dip, it is 50. Then when you are washing your floor, it can be 100 to 200. But your food contact surfaces, like your table, equipment, and utensils, you can see very well it has to be just 50 to 100. So here, I would like this, at least the concentration people should remember. Aditya, I will clarify your tariff doubt. Okay.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
Then what is the role of MPEDA? You must be looking around. Your MPEDA office is there and EIC office is also there. But what all their roles? So their EIC is there with the health certificate and other things. But MPEDA is also there who are looking for the certification, particularly in the aquaculture side. Okay, so they have to give only PHT, post-harvest test report. Now it is changed. Those certificates only when it will be given, then only these industries will be able to export their consignments. And these European unions actually require, they should adhere to your European Union maximum residue level. And these levels are actually, it is very well regulated, and those who are particularly your NABL accredited like us, so they are already mentioning, okay, whether it is acceptable or unacceptable like that. Then for certification of EU require adherence to Global GAP version 3.1, November 2009, which is a voluntary standard. See, all standards will be the voluntary. But somehow, if you see, it becomes mandatory. If you don't accept you cannot have your business. And if you don't have your business, your GDP will not grow. So somehow, maybe it is voluntary, but simultaneously, it is mandatory. But as per the conditions, as per the scenario, because there climatic conditions and here climatic conditions are there. And if you have studies and well reported, so very well, if some limits are there, 0.5, you can have one also, but it all based on your scientific logics. So that is why in the first itself I was talking about that scientific background. So whatever you are justifying, it should be scientifically proven that yes, these are not harmful. Otherwise, it will not be accepted. You cannot just blindly make out anything and nobody will accept. Okay, so they are giving organic certification, this MPEDA, that organic certification EU require as per their regulation, it is 710/2009, then for US, North America, and many other countries, so they are providing certificates. Then, ultimately, what all the tariff barriers we were talking about, TBT for the exports. So definitely, see, business is such a where you don't want hindrance and you are going to compete also, and nobody. If suppose I have to do business in Cochin and I belong to Patna, so really it will be difficult for me. So that is why. If suppose people from India, they have to go there. So there are some mutual agreement has to be there. And that is why harmonization is required. So there, to remove all such barriers, harmonized testing procedures have been laid down with the standards. So where they will take care of all the contaminants, which will safeguard their consumers. See, here you need to understand, it is not what you are exporting to those countries. See, they look for their people first. If they are accepting those kind of consignment and those kind of food products, if they will consume, how much loss can be there? So they cannot play with their human. Okay, so they are taking all such stringent, all such cases they are taking up. Okay, so there in standard of rejections of seafood, and subsequently you have seen a lot of rejections are also happening when we are exporting, and there you will have major issues of antibiotic and your particular some microbiological contaminants also. A few years back we had a lot of hue cry for the Vibrios. So some will tell, okay, Vibrio parameticus is not pathogenic, but still there are some pathogenic strains. So when you will look for the biological, these all species, so there you will come to know, okay, that is why some counts have been given there. It is not that even presence or absence like Salmonella or Staph, in the slides you will see, the specific pathogens like Salmonella, your Listeria monocytogen, it has to be absent. Okay, because even one is there, that may affect your human health. But some are there, like your parahemolyticus, where count will be there needed to go with the acceptable line. And why it is that? Because they have certain virulence genes which are making people sick. There, one more thing is there, that rapid alert system. If suppose some unwanted thing has been at the border, so their alert will be given to that exporting countries, and they have to look into those scenario. And there your CIFT and EIC is taking care of, so that if possible those rejected things can be taken back, or satisfactorily if it is possible. Otherwise, most of the time what is happening, people are destroying, because what they have done with this, rejection will be there from other countries, and here the market, people think that nobody will look into it, and they will go to the local market. So you don't want to harm others because it is restricted by people, but here you want to harm your own guys. So that is why now you can see in last 4 or 5 years, FSSAI is very much active. Even we are working with FSSAI. So there, really, that is, it is nothing that if you have to do business, you can do anything. I cannot do like that. Okay, so that is why destruction of consignments are not now being taking place, so that a business operator should not do such, because people mind is there, and they will look, money is ultimate, so they will go for that. Okay, no, I have to make my money, but ultimately how much loss is there, people don't account for that. Then when you see, there are certain barriers which are put, so I will show you this slide. So there you can see in 2012 your anti-dumping duty came because of this antibiotic. So lot of antibiotics were given. So after many rejections, that is why now that MPDA has taken up to have your reports from the aquaculture side itself, only to safeguard trade. Okay, and to ultimately to safeguard the consumer, because if your antibiotics are there, people are not going to accept. You cannot have your business. You trade is completely gone. So there, in 2012, you see just 30 samples they took, and there they could find the banned antibiotic. See, antibiotics means that will lead to the cancers. Okay, some acceptable limits are there, which will be there, and it can be washed out. But see, a huge quantity, if it will go to the liver, and if it is getting accumulated, definitely destruction of cells and other things will be there, and ultimately it result to the cancer. And now you can see very well, cancer number is increasing day by day, even in India. And why it is? It is not that our food system has gone wrong, it is because of frauds. Okay, people are not ethical with their businesses. Whatever they are getting, they are supplying to the local market and people, and how people will look into it, they are not going to test that. Okay, so that is how regulatory agencies are very much important, and such a restriction, hard restriction, even I say much more hard it has to be there. See, it is not that only your export is very much important, our local markets are also important. And now you can see the scenario, if you are exporting, you are getting less value in comparison to local market. So anyway, there is the continuous supply, so that is not matter of debate. But here also, people are taking care. So you see, in 2012 itself, they have looked for the banned antibiotic, and in that 10% sought these pharmacologically active substance drugs are there. See, all antibiotics, like Indian scenario, it is not you put and people have to eat that, okay. To control, okay, shrimp will not die, you put any antibiotic. So they are also, now our regulatory agencies are working on it so that we can have certain guidelines, some certain doctors, particularly from the BFSC side, who can prescribe. None of the people are there in India who can prescribe medicine for the feces till today. But it's not late, people are taking care, now talks are going on. So hopefully soon things will be on the track, and those who will know, they only will be dealing with such things. So hopefully in India also they will take care. So that is how, with that, they make barrier, and it is barrier on export. You understand, one political is also there. There we don't have to look into it, because see, local market will also look into it, how it is. So there also, now I don't have to have a bad relation with others. So that is how a common platform is also created, what I was talking about. So some, and the barrier which has been put, particularly to have a security on the bioterrorism. So now I think first line, everybody in this class, they will understand why such regulations are very, very much important. See, those things can be transported, that can be transferred, that can be exchanged through anything. Okay. And you can see in between the talk was also there, the COVID has been transferred from there to here. And one, what you can say, it is myth or reality, we don't know. It was used as a bio weapon. So God knows and they know what exactly it is. But still, these microbes have become a weapon to fight among the countries. So there we are not going into it. So Indian export consignment has also been rejected under the country of origin. So that labeling regulation I was talking about. So labeling is mandatory. Yesterday, Ankur was also talking about labeling, about the HILSA. So it is caught from, suppose caught from Bengal, it will be mentioned in Bangladesh. So there actually some techniques are there, like your HRMS and things. So we are also growing into that, and their country of origin, we will be knowing. Earlier we were knowing, okay, what fish it can be. Now with those sophisticated equipment, we will come to know with their isotopes, okay, from where exactly it has come. Okay. Then recently last year, we had a problem with this turtle excluded devices from FDA. So there we modified our net, and then we justified with the FDA, and then now exports are going. And you see, with the subsequent time it was there, and in 2007, this what your tariff Aditya was talking about. So you make so much tariff duties, so that people will unable to put your things into your market. So you, and every percent is not feasible. See how much margin will be there. So with that margin only a business is done. So after get making out so much hue and cry, then anti-dumping duty, that tariff was reduced from 10 to 7. So almost 3% it was decreased, and 3% is a big amount. We cannot we may account, okay, it is a thousands, but their businesses goes in the crores. So crore, if you look for the crore and the 3% there, so it's a quite good saving. So that is what a good thing happened. And subsequently also it will be reduced. Then there are a lot of trade agreements between India, Sri Lanka, then in your South Asian free trade, SAFTA also we have the signatories, then with the Asian countries also. So a lot of treaties, things are there only to harmonize trade. Okay. So with Japan, Bangladesh and everybody, we have our agreement with that. Then BIS, BIS, there Bureau of Indian Standards, which is having IS 160-22-2012. So they deal with the food management, food safety management requirement for good hygienic practices. So this hygienic practices will go throughout your food chain, and ultimately, if you look into it, it will go for the suitability of the human consumption. Okay, so there are different regulations which it is there. If students want, they can have my slides and they can read, but everything is not important to remember there. But if it is required, suppose you are a working industry and you have to deal with that, so there you have to go with the particular guideline. Suppose you are going for the frozen shrimps, so there you need to go with the IS 2237 1997. So there you browse everything, okay, what all the requirements are there, and then you can very well regulate. So for your crab meat, your frozen cuttlefish, edible fish powder, so for everything there are separate standards. So your frozen tuna tuna canned in curry, then your frozen minced meat, then your clam meat, even your fish pickle. So these all guidelines have been put by your BIS. Here, what do you know? I was talking about what is residue? Okay, the traces of pesticides or antibiotic in the treated products are called residue. It is not that whole you are treating and that will be accounted as your residue. So whatever is your left there, so that will be considered a residue. So just you think in the terms of your Hindi words, so you will understand that. Then there a term I was talking about, your maximum residue level, and this purposefully I have put so that my BFSC juniors, they will know the things, otherwise it will never be known, okay, what he was talking about. So MRL is maximum residue level, is the highest level of pesticide. I am talking about in respect of pesticide residue that is legally tolerated. Means I was telling about what a human body can tolerate, and these all things are based on your toxicological studies. Okay, simply it is nothing people are prescribing, okay, because it is not seen. So inside our body itself, it will do plus or minus to make out things. So the maximum permitted level, what it can be tolerated when it is used in food or feed, that only describes as your MRL. So that is also, you can say it comes under your GAP, GMP or whatever it is. So in the veterinary drug and in your pesticide, you will see maximum such terms will be used, your MRL and your such residue terminologies. Now, certain guidelines which I hope people should remember always and everywhere it will be, because when you are seeing the test report, this will be defined in that, and there you have to take decisions whether my food is complying with the regulations or not. And this is given by FAO. So you can see the heavy metals like arsenic, 76 to 86 are prescribed. For the cadmium, it is quite high, but here when you, I will show you in the subsequent, it will be less also. Then lead, methyl mercury is one, then your PCBs are two, then your pesticides, didrine and other DDT, those things are there. They have the limits. Okay, and even for dioxins, now dioxin is costing a lot of testing itself, costing around 50,000. And how this dioxins comes, maybe your this paints and other things what you are using. So that is why when in the industry they are using some paintings, and so there they have to look into it, what kind of paint they are using. Okay, then these are from the compliances from the FDA, and there I think HACCP class was there, so physical hazard they must have taught you. So there also it is defined what kind of hard or sharp object is has to be there in your food. So that has to be generally 7 mm or maximum 18 mm. And you can see section 555.425. So that compliance document, it is already mentioned there. But here, now you don't have to assess and go for the guidelines. From here itself, you can come to know, okay, what the size of physical items which will be there, which will be rejected. So there you can think, if it is 0.3 to 1, it is acceptable. If it is more than 1, it is unacceptable. Then natural toxins. So you must have seen many guidelines are there in your bivalves. So why it is there? See, all these toxins have their different behaviors and their occurrence also. So that is why you see your Ciguatera, it was there 3 years back even in India. And there you can see very well differences are there in the Caribbean, in Indian. And there you can see guidance level have not been established yet. Because that scientific studies and those kind of data are not available on which they can very well defined, because it is a very diverse. So when it will be in research, really, we will know how difficult it is. So whatever guidelines are there, so your for NSP Brevet toxins, it is just 0.8, and when you consider a mouse unit, it will be 20. Then your ASP amniotic selfish poisoning domoic acid, it is 20 milligram per kg. Then for your Okadai DSP and your PSP, it is more than or equal to 0.8 milligram per kg is not acceptable. Okay, and you can see in the DSP, it is very less than that, just a 0.16. The most important thing, what we look for the histamine, it should not go more than 500 ppm in any fresh things, and in decomposed one it should not be more than 50. Decomposed means maybe taking one step ahead of the fresh. Then your DDT, TDE, all this should be less than 5 ppm. And all these are given in the your guidelines with the sections what we are seeing. Okay, as per section this and this, this kind of punishment is there, this is there. So like that, these things are also there in the their policy guidelines. So for the biological hazard also, they have given for all fish. You can see Clostridium botulinum. It should not be there at all. And even they have to look for the presence of toxins. See, just I was talking about your Listeria monocytogenes and Salmonella. So they need to be absent. Okay. So there we are not going with the quantitative, just we are going with the qualitative aspect. But when you go for the staph aureus, so there you can see it is just 4 log. It is acceptable. And why it is required? Because if higher is there, then very well you can think of the conditions are not satisfactory and it's completely unhygienic control, insanitary practices were there. Then for the vibrios, you can see it is cooked. For the cooked, it is presence of organism, but for raw, it is not. Okay, so there you can very well see what is in cooked and what is in raw. So every time our mind and eye has to be open what we are looking for. So the for the cooked, even vibrios should be absent, whatever it is. But in the raw, you see vibrio cholera, your presence and absence are mandatory. But in the if you see for parahemolyticus, as I was telling, okay, the counts you can take it up, but in the cooked it is not. So in the raw vivals you can see almost 4 logs are acceptable. Okay, but in the cooked it is not. Okay, and for vibrio vulnificus also some limits that they have given of 30. So beyond that it is unacceptable. Okay, then in the animal drug, if you see chloramphenicol, your diethyl estilbestrol, so lot of animal drugs are there which are banned, and these residues of these drugs should not be present in the muscles of animal at all. Okay, for all fishes it is there, your glycopeptides, chloramphenicol, everything, what it is there in the first row, it is everything. Then for finfish and lobster, your sum of tetracyclines is there. For freshwater, you can see some guideline they have put, particularly for because these catfishes and salmons, they are culturing more, so that is why they have kept this. For IMC and others, maybe your FSSAI will be. So these are certain antibiotics which are very well used, but they have to be used as per the guidelines. Then in case of pesticide, you can see your benzene hexachloride just 0.3. Then your, I was already telling, aldrin, dieldrin, endrin, all 0.3, and DDT is 5 ppm. It will be less than that, it will only be acceptable. So Canada and Russia, they have only uniform limit of 0.1 ppm. EU also has 0.1 ppm. It will not go with this. This is for India. So now we will come to the FSSAI, who is regulating food safety and standard as per the Food Safety and Standard Act 2006. This act to consolidate the law and relating to food and establishing the food safety and standards for laying down the science-based standards. So since it's starting, I was talking about your scientific base. So everything have to have your scientific basis. It is nothing that your IT get some traditional knowledge were there that you put. It is not acceptable at all. Okay, so those standard has to be your should have your scientific base to regulate the manufacture, storage, distribution, sale and import to ensure availability of safe and wholesome food for the human consumption. And if it is related, anywhere it is. Okay, so this scope will not be so important, I think. this will so these all guidelines are there for general provision as to articles of food. No article of food shall contain any additive or processing unless it is in accordance with the provision. So I was so there are regulations for additives also. So there should not be any contaminant. So all pesticide within the MRL, it has to be there. Okay. And for that, offenses and legal penalties are also there. For imports also, it is there. All imports of the articles of food are subjected to that 2006 Act. No person shall import food into India. Means if it is unsafe or misbranded or substandards. Okay, any material of food for the import of which a license is required under the Act need to be taken. There are some items may not need, but there some guidelines are there, so that you have to be any article of the food in contravention of any other provision of the Act. So everything you have to go with the Act to look into it. So there are guidelines, food safety and standard, laboratory and sample analysis regulation 2011, and there these two will be important to look into it. And there when the reports are there or things are there, there everything is prescribed what I will in the subsequent slide you can see. So in those guidelines you can see for the frozen total volatile base in the raw it is 30 milligram per 100 milligram, but in the cooked it has to be absent. So earlier I was talking about raw and cooked, those two are different things. So there always we have to be very much careful. Then for the frozen squid or the part of squid, so there you don't have to look into it. Whatever squid is there, it is raw or cooked, it should not go beyond 30 milligram per 100 gram. Okay. Then your dried, actually sharks are banned now. But still, apart from that, 8 species, some can be going to the trade. And there you need to have the moisture should not be less than, should not be more than 10%. Then your yeast and mold count, as it is dried product, it has to be absent. Then this will be the most important because it is highly traded, your salted and dried fish. Okay, so it will be water activities 0.78, then your histamine here, earlier there it was 500, here you can see only 200. Okay, so all such guidelines are there, even your canned fish you can see whatever is required, things are there. For your retort pouch, you can see tensile strength just 3 to 5, then your bond strength, then your bursting strength. It is so all such important requirements have to be met when you are exporting or importing the things. Then your fish for fish edible powder is also there. For fish pickle also, it is lot in the market. So fluid portion has to be maximum 40%. Then your pH should be between 4 to 4.5. It should not be more. It is because ultimately it will go for the Clostridium botulinum, so those toxins. Okay, and the sodium chloride also, it has to be in the max of 12% only. Okay, so for means product, different characteristics, criteria, things are there. Then I think my time is up. Okay, then for fish oil also, things are there. For your BHT, BHT, BHA, BHT, everything, they have prescribed what is the number. Then for sardine oil, you can see free fatty acid, what it has to be, moisture, what it can be. Then iodine value, just it has to be 145 to 180. Then what I am going to tell here, so here you can see things, this safety indicators for the different products. They have given the microbiological guidelines. Okay, so 5 log or 7 log in the fresh, it has to be. So N and by, So it has to be only 5 into 10 raised to power 5. So almost near to 5 log it has to be there. In the chilled and frozen crustacean, it has to be 6 log, not more. Okay, so for different food category, they have given different microbiological standards. Okay, and these standards can be tested as per the test method, what it has been laid down in the guidelines itself, in the regulation itself, they have mentioned. Okay, your IS 5402, which will be subsequent with the ISO 4833. So this only testing method has to be used, not any other method. Otherwise, your reports will not be acceptable. So certain for E. coli, Salmonella, and different limits are there. Then for that also, you can see different guidelines are there. Then for the toxic substances, why I had told. So different countries, only slight variations are there. So in the final, what I will tell, see, food safety and nutrition, it is inseparable link. So unsafe food, particularly, it is problematic for infants, elderly, and sick. Now you can see in the COVID, that is more getting affected with the 20 to 40 years of age group. So it is not acceptable for any human being. So that foodborne diseases are also retarding your socioeconomic development, your terrorism, economic, trade, and everything. And the food supply chain, which is going across the border. So good collaboration for the government, producer, and consumers are required for the food safety. And what our responsibility is to know the food they use, they should be familiarized with what common hazards are there, and that we have to take care, handle and prepare food safely, and practice the way to handle food safe at home. And if you are selling in the restaurant, local market, or whatever you are doing trade, try to have proper handling. So in the final, I will tell, it is not a one-man show. It is each and everybody's responsibility to keep the food safe. Thank you, Ketan.
Thank you very much, sir. As we have discussed that into our training program, we have to start with the potential. That potential things has been described by Dr. Priyadarshi, sir. And after that, all 8 technologies we had covered in the training. And after the technology, what should be the outcome? That is, we have to export the things. So that exporting, yes. Exporting thing is that I'm thinking that you should cover. So that thing you had performed very well, sir. And elaborately you have told that how the expo, different countries having a different standards. And after that, what is our requirement and all that things you have covered, sir. So it was a very nice presentation, sir. And if students want it, you can ask from me, because sir has already sent to me. Sir, you can close that screen, sir. Screen sharing. You can close.
1 minute. Yes, sir.
Okay, yes.
So Ketan, here actually I thought it took me 10 days to compile everything, 10 to 15 days, since you told. So I was trying and then editing the things. And finally, I thought I should give at least... If suppose today they are not, but maybe tomorrow, at least if they have in the consolidated versions, so they can very well assess. If they don't have to browse the things and look, okay, what it will be. They don't have to connect to people to look into it. So here in the one, just only, once they will browse, they will come to know. And for you people, I think it will be more beneficial. You can have this and very well teach the students. And here, actually, I wanted... to make people aware, okay, and why regulations are really important, okay. So ultimately it goes to human health, and now every day we are struggling to survive. So now at this scenario, people will very much realize how it is important and why people are not allowing things, okay.
Definitely, sir, your efforts is reflects into your presentation. So so that to collecting this much of information, it's required quite a lot effort. So that was reflected into your presentation. So now I request to the students, if you have any questions, you can ask Pankaj sir. Will definitely. Yes, sir. Please.
Aditya was asking something, huh?
Sir, I have a question regarding food security. How can we assess the impact of climate change on food security?
See, impact assessment, if we have to do, okay. So you can very well see around your place itself, okay. But if assessment has to be done, now you can see very well in the 10 years of duration, what it was 2010 and now 2020. Earlier, if you go to the last century, definitely accessibility was not there for the food also. But now, at least our living standards have increased. Now everybody is getting food. At least in India, you can see malnutrition is not there. I don't know about some pockets. So their government is taking care of things, and there are organizations who are taking things in the same way. Okay. So sir, if you want to have some research on this, so there you need to contact some institutions where really you can make into it.
Regarding exporting, is there any sort of subsidy provided to the exporters?
Yes. MPDA is providing subsidies. Okay, so some schemes are also there. So those are provided with the industries. Okay. So if you want to have subsidy, so there also some guidelines are there. So you have to satisfy those norms, and there you will be eligible to have some. A simple example I will give, just you see in your Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana. So yes, same sir. Kind of schemes are there. So just you correlate with things, you will understand. And see, now government is very well supporting entrepreneurs. A single entrepreneur, they don't have economy to go for the export or have the business. So there they need support. So like that, for the industry also, government has the schemes to give subsidies. And for your insulated vehicles, for your many things, such schemes are there. I don't much aware about the scheme because we are not handling. Mostly MPDA and your EIC is handling. We are mostly into your testing side. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Anything else?
Any other student can also ask the question.
I have time. I have the next meeting by 12:45. So I have half an hour.
Hello, sir.
Ah.
Sir. My question is, if one consignment is rejected by any country, how exporter manage these laws? And is there any insurance?
See, it all depends on there. Actually, insurance is not acceptable at all. How you can play with the human? Okay. Try to understand that. Okay. You have no right to play with the human. Even your IPC tells that. Okay. So it is better not to give insurance and make out the thing for those kind. Because, see, already guidelines have been put. And still, to save some money, you are making things wrong for other people. So is it acceptable? So better, what? Bolo Pinak.
No, sir. Continue, sir.
So is it acceptable? See, with the common sense itself, we can very well realize it is better to destroy. See, if I have something, some liberty, if I will give, what will happen? If suppose I will leave some culprit without any punishment, what will happen? Same thing will be repeated. So that is why some penalties also are there. And in that, they are putting, let the... You cannot play with the people. Ultimately, we are living for human being. And see, food is the most critical thing where people are earlier they were taking advantage, but now they are not taking advantage so much. Because, see, we are also responsible for things. Okay. And you cannot be irresponsible. So that is how it is highly unacceptable, and to give insurance to them, I am not agreed with that.
Yes, sir, it is a rejected consignment is reusable or destroyed?
It all depends on what is the acceptability limits are there. Suppose it has to be taken back to the local market. Maybe it is satisfying your regulatory requirement. So very well, you can take return and distribute in your market. But before that, what it has to be done, those samples will be tested in your country, and then your report will be produced. Then your regulatory authority will tell, okay, it can go into the market or not. Okay, so there are things, and things are going like that also. And in that also, I will tell you, still people are manipulating. They know, okay, so much cadmium will be there, so much antibiotic will be there. Still, they will try to make my consignment was not having any antibiotic and things. So those we are not supporting at all. Okay. So guidelines are there. If they want, they can, but it has to be within regulatory requirements. Okay.
Sir, my next question is very linked to Pinax. Is there there is a loophole in every trade? So is there any loophole in our fish trade, world fish trade?
Loopholes, those kind of things are political. Okay. That doesn't deal with our requirement at all. Loophole, see, for everything, things will be there. Some will feel it is hard for me, some will feel it is soft for me. So it is not to discuss those things.
Okay. Okay.
And sometimes the people make these things, and mostly what you are seeing, it becomes political only. Okay. Nothing with the regulations and those things.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Hello, sir.
Bolo.
Sir, in country trading, this certificate is needed, means for ornamental fish business in countries, in India only. In India, trading.
Obviously, yes, it is required because you have to pass the border of that other country. Okay.
Sir, note, export note, in India country. Example, ornamental fish business.
नहीं पीनट साहब, एक बात आप सिंपल आप समझ जाओ, अगर इंटरनल आप रेगुलेट कर रहे हो, इफ यू आर रेगुलेटिंग, ओके, देन आल्सो सपोज ट्रांसपोर्टेशन इज देयर, सम रेगुलेशंस आर देयर, देयर यू नीड टू हैव टेस्ट एंड देन यू ओनली यू कैन हैव इंटरस्टेट ट्रांसफर, ओके, बट इट ऑल डिपेंड्स, नाउ इट इज नॉट सो मच स्ट्रिक्ट इनसाइड आवर विसिनिटी, बिकॉज we are promoting business first, okay, and if suppose something will be there with the fish, they are not going to transfer that. Okay, understood?
Yes,
so
sir.
Those kind of requirement for ornamental fish within the boundary, it is not there, but some testing protocol has to be there, are there, particularly for your WSSB and other things for the seeds. They have. For ornamental fish, I don't know. But it is not there, I think. But now you see, labs are coming up. So in subsequent time, those things, what you are expecting, it will come. For your transportation, you need to have the test. It is not that Argolis is there in your farm and it will be transported from Kerala to Gujarat. So Kerala is already contaminated. Full Gujarat will get contaminated. So subsequently, see, infrastructure also has to develop. So government is taking care of. And about now regulations in ornamental, I don't think so it is there.
Sir, one question more. If we may...
It is the product which is patented. Okay. So the for the